Season 4 of Angel was really, I think, our best season. It's been different than any season, and everything has gotten incredibly intense.
The season begins just kind of putting everything back together again, getting everybody back, you know, and dealing with the ramifications of that and Connor's betrayal.
You murdered my father.
I didn't.
She knows it. Connor! Never forget that I'm your father and that I love you.
You don't get to die. You get to live forever.
Connor has kind of tried to get rid of his father by sinking him to, locking him down in a box and sinking him into the Pacific Ocean and put him in this unpeculiar situation.
Season 4 opens basically with Angel's fantasy of, you know, the world the way he wants it to be.
I want to freeze this moment. You, Connor, all of us. Safe and happy and together.
Angel's down there hallucinating that he's having a happy life with his friends and his son.
I can poke your eyes out.
Come on, Dad, it'll stick up like yours.
Yeah, you should be so lucky.
We decided to play it real time, that he's been down there all this time, and Gunn and Fred have been searching for him fruitlessly.
This year started with Gunn and Fred together, as well as running Angel investigations by ourselves, because Angel was in the bottom of the sea, Cordelia was in the heavens, Wesley was off on his own.
Wesley is still on the outs from the kidnapping and the fallout of that in season 3. So between the two seasons, Wesley has been out searching tirelessly for Angel. Wesley's captured Justine and is using her to help him locate the coffin.
You really think finding Angel's gonna change anything?
Everything changes.
Well, I guess anything's better than sitting around in my cage all day with nothing to do but to fill my bucket.
Perhaps you should have considered that before slitting my throat.
The big quest for the first episode was certainly, you know, a show called Angel. We need Angel back in the show.
Finally, our man Wes pulls him up.
Luckily for both of them, he does find Angel and drags him up and uncovers him and brings him back using his own blood, which is a kind of sort of beautiful twist in a way.
Everyone was kind of gone except for Jay and I, so we had sort of spent the summer looking for everyone and hadn't had much luck with anything.
Where have you been?
I'm sorry. I shouldn't run off alone. You think I'd know that by now?
It's that big, thick melon. Your dad's got one just like it.
The sinister Vincent Kartheiser acting like, you know, a normal part of their family, trying to help them find out what happened to Angel. And we as an audience know that, of course, it was Vincent that dropped him to the bottom of the ocean.
I can't imagine what you've been through, Connor. Being taken away by Holtz, raised in that place. It must have been horrible. I know you're still hurting, but I promise it's not nearly as much as you're gonna hurt for what you did to your father.
We were kind of at this spot where we didn't know where to go, and all of a sudden, people start showing up.
I believe you're looking for this.
Angel.
And Angel comes back and sets things straight.
Sit down.
Connor was very confused with realizing that it wasn't Angel who killed Holtz, but rather his partner in crime.
Holtz killed himself. Actually, he had your buddy Justine do it with an ice pick. Just to make you hate me. I tried telling you that while you were busy offshore dumping me, but I didn't know the whole score.
You still deserved it.
What I deserve is open to debate. So now, the question becomes, what do you deserve? Daddy's not finished talking.
He confronts his son and tells him to leave the hotel and get out of his life and figure things out for himself.
Nothing in the world is the way it ought to be. It's harsh and cruel, but that's why there's us. Champions. We live as though the world were as it should be, to show it what it can be. You're not a part of that yet. I hope you will be.
Angel basically says, you know, straighten up. Be the hero you should be, and then maybe you can come back.
I love you, Connor. Now get out of my house. Wesley told me everything that's been going on.
Angel!
We found Angel with the help of Wesley, who slowly makes his way back into the group. His return to the group sort of causes a lot of friction between Fred and I.
They were this very happy couple, and we thought, well, how can we keep them interesting? And when we came up with supersymmetry and what Gunn was willing to do for her.
Ah, oh, that's my girl! Oh. All right, hand this thing over. Let me check it out.
Page 19. It's not a big article, not like it's featured or anything.
Got it. Supersymmetry.
MP-dimensional subspace by Winifred Burkle. We started off pretty strong, which is, you know, that was going into about 6 months of going out, which I think is long for a Joss Whedon show.
Fred, thank God. Look, there's something we gotta tell you. The portal.
It was Professor Seidel.
Yeah.
And he's done it before.
That's right. There are others.
No. To me, he's the son of a bitch that sent me to Pylea. I found out that my professor had was killing people and had sent me to Pylea, and I wanted to take revenge.
We're gonna get this guy.
Count on it. He's gonna pay.
No. He's gonna die.
He was a very horrible, evil man who'd killed a lot of people. But we don't have our characters kill humans. We kill monsters and demons and vampires. We don't kill people.
My character is trying to convince her not to kill him, but she is hell-bent on killing him.
Let's talk about this.
Talk? Sure, let's talk, because you gave me the chance to... Oh, wait. No, you didn't.
My character realizes that if he lets her kill him, he'll lose her because she won't be the same person and she won't look at herself the same way.
Don't let him do this to you!
How dare you? You don't know! You don't know what it was like!
If you kill him, I'm gonna lose you.
He realizes that the only way for her to get what she wants and for him to still keep her is to kill the professor for her.
And they killed a person. And, thinking that would bring them together, but that secret is ultimately what I think drove them apart and is something that still haunts them.
Fred, what do you want from me?
Nothing.
Yeah, you've made that pretty clear.
That's not what I meant.
You sure? We haven't even touched each other since...
Since we murdered Professor Seidel.
No, since I did.
For me.
I couldn't let you carry that.
It wasn't your choice.
One thing I love about Joss shows is there are moral consequences. If you take an action, there is a consequence to that action. And rarely, if ever, do you get away with something. It may take a while, but eventually it will come home and bite you in the ass.
And so the relationship is completely, torn apart by this murder. Then not to mention, Wesley decides to come back and decides that he really wants to be with Fred. So he does some things to get what he wants that drive us even further apart.
You better tell me what the hell I just walked in on.
We were just...
What, researching?
You want to do this deal with me, leave Fred out of it.
You ought to be leaving Fred out of it.
Hello, I'm here.
You think I don't see the way you look at her? Stay away from her.
By the end of the season, we have to break up because there's just too much water under the bridge,
All we ever do is turn away.
Fred, I
know. Whatever Wes was feeling, whatever he thought might... I should have told him it was never going to happen. You think I don't know that?
It's not what I was going to say.
But it's what you think.
And in the midst of this, Cordelia came back from her otherworldly experience and didn't know anybody.
Who are you people?
My God, it's you. You're back.
Okay. Who am I?
It's
a lot of unanswered questions. Where she was that night, where she's been, obviously. Is the relationship going to be the same between Angel and Cordelia? How is that going to come about? Is she going to remember things? She's obviously oblivious to everything. She's lost her memory. So because of that, it affects everybody.
That could have been a disaster. Welcome back. You're safe. By the way, there's a green demon right behind you.
Don't you think we should tell her? I mean, we do live in a world of demons and icky things. She's bound to find out.
Well, yeah, sure. But, I mean, let's be smart. I want her to remember who I am before I freak her out with the whole undead drinks blood part of my resume.
He's obviously excited, but at the same time hurt and confused that she doesn't remember a lot of things, and he wants to be there for her.
I want to help you get those memories back.
Great. But not tonight.
I understand. If you need any...
I will.
You really are among friends.
So I think you find him in a place of desperation, trying to kind of hold on to something they had in the past and try to hopefully spark something that could, you know, ignite her conscience.
Cordy. You remember?
I remember all of it. And I have to be alone.
Connor kind of took her in and had his own little place set up. I don't know why he chose a warehouse full of dead animals, but it seemed to suit him well.
What is this place?
Home.
It does look like he's learning his lesson and becoming the hero, and then he falls under the evil sway of Cordelia.
Every time I close my eyes, I...
What?
See it. Something horrible. Moving. Deep down, clawing its way up.
Just a dream.
I can taste the blood of all the people it's going to kill, smell the burning flesh.
It's okay. You're safe with me.
No one's safe. Don't you understand that? It's coming and no one can stop it.
Her coming back without her memory was actually helping to cause, like, the end of the world.
What is it?
Place. I've been here before.
In your vision?
No. Oh my God. Darla.
My mother.
She died here. Connor, this is where you were born.
Seven, when we brought the beast, and that sort of started to bring everybody together.
Maybe if we pool our data.
I'm gonna find my girlfriend.
No, you're not. If we don't stop what's coming, it won't matter where Fred is or any of us.
With Rain of Fire, we see that the group is unified again. They decide that everything that they have going against each other, they decided to, you know, hey, we're in this together, and in order for us to kind of come out better on the other end, we have to work together.
Angel goes to Lila, gets these secret papers that have been decoded, and they piece together a location for the beast, where this thing, this mighty apocalyptic monster, is supposed to show up.
That's everything Wolfram and Hart could decipher from what they took out of Lorne.
They just handed these over.
Lila, she can be very giving.
Finally, Wesley comes back to the fold 100%, and we take on the beast.
Okay, what's the plan?
You're holding it. We figure out what all this means, then do something large and violent.
And then they rush over to destroy it, somewhat foolhardily, and the beast basically kicks everybody's ass handily.
This beast, who was, you know, it was impossible to defeat, comes in and really is just kicking all of our asses, and we try every move we can possibly think of, which does not work.
Wesley sort of pops him with these two guns, and You know, I'm running up from under this bar and taking my slice of the beast, and he knocks me far away, and then Angel comes at him and gets thrown off the roof. No! Everyone on the set was like, wow, that was intense.
You know, that was a way of signaling to the audience that, you know, we're going to another level with this.
You know how you feel about me, Connor? You never had a childhood, or family, or friends, or anything that's real. And if this is the end, I want you to have something that is.
Lo and behold, a couple of weeks with the old Connor, man, and the vampire dust kind of goes into the eyes, and you never know what'll happen, and we were making whoopee, man. Me and Cordelia Chase. That kind of put a rift back between Angel and Connor for a couple of episodes.
And all the while, you know, the apocalypse is taking place. So there's like a personal apocalypse as well as a global one.
The episodes get very, very dark, literally.
Prophecies start coming true, and the beast pretty much evolves.
Begins pulling souls and pieces of the puzzle together to start the apocalypse in motion. And our gang are all set on making sure this does not happen, that the sun remains in the sky and that the good people of Los Angeles can live on.
Armageddon is very close at hand. People are riding outside. You know, all demons are coming out of their nooks and crannies, and just to kind of destroy Los Angeles. And this beast figure is kind of running amok, so to speak.
We discovered the beast plan.
To blot out the sun for all of eternity.
The sun.
His goal is to sort of create eternal darkness, to shut out the lights for real.
Why is it still getting dark?
I told you once. You need not be my enemy. Join with me. Angel.
The answer is among you.
Angel, I saw you long ago standing in a field of bodies with the beast.
I'm telling you, I don't know this beast.
But Angelus might.
The idea was to bring in a beast who is truly epic and apocalyptic, find out, you know, and then find out that he really is in service of getting Angelus.
They have to deal with it by trying to figure out how to stop this beast, and that's when they have to come up with this idea of bringing Angelus back.
There's only one way we're going to defeat this beast. We need Angelus.
Wesley realizes that, you know, maybe bringing Angelus back would be good for the group to kind of figure out, since he's known him from his past, they can get information on how to kill this guy.
Bringing Angelus brings with it a whole other host of unforeseen problems and complications. And of course opens up the writers to all of their extraordinary imaginative ideas. And so things really snowball.
What is that?
It is the Mo Ping, the receptacle that will house his soul. It is done.
In the process, Angel's soul, which is placed in a jar, is sort of misplaced by the, you know, duplicitous Cordelia.
What? Angel's soul? It's gone.
And I think that's really the master plan of Cordelia, is to unleash Angel's evil side in order to use that as a way of one of her tools.
Guess again.
No.
out of the cage and he terrorizes everybody. I kind of knew that was on the brink. He was suffocated for a while, so it was good to come out and exercise his personality.
This time, you stay down. As for you, luscious thing. I mean, you were gonna let me out of that cage, so let's see, I'll give you what, a 10-second start?
10, 9, now there's a girl who takes advantage of her opportunity.
Don't be jealous, kitten. She's just the warm-up. I'll save the good stuff for you.
Angelus's return to the series was fun, you know, for a lot of reasons, because it was really great to watch Angel. I'm sorry. Ooh, I just called David Angel.
You know, you're lucky I'm letting you yak this long.
To watch David relish playing that role, you know, it was really hilarious because, you know, he just loved playing it, and to watch him do it every day was a lot of fun.
What's good about this character is that you're constantly challenging yourself. The writers are constantly challenging him. So I think because of that, they've left the door open to kind of go down different roads with him, which is very appealing to me and always has been when I started the show. So the fact that that remains open and the writers are doing that and challenging me, it's been very refreshing.
Oh, come on, Rocky, if that's all you got, you better throw in the towel and call it a night.
When the Beastmaster's ready to peek out from behind your skirt, have him give me a call.
Well, you handled that brilliantly. I haven't spent all this time and energy so you can mess it all up with your petty jealousies. You know Angelus is crucial to my plan.
This beast that they cannot hope to defeat is actually second in command, that the real monster is inside Cordelia.
The significance of the beast is that it really throws the group off in a lot of directions, because we think that it has something to do with Connor. We think that the beast has arrived because of Connor, that it has some connection to Connor. Then we realize he actually has a connection to Angel, but then we realize he actually has the connection to Cordelia. So the beast keeps the group guessing.
There's a sort of domino effect. So each measure creates a countermeasure, which needs a measure and a countermeasure.
We're gonna save Angel. And I know who we need to help us do it.
So Faith springs herself from prison with the news of Angelus that Wesley brings her.
Angelus is back.
Step away from the glass.
I think having some character like Faith come back at a pivotal point when she finds out that Angelus is loose is really, for her character, a way of saying, you know, I'm paying you back, Angel, for saving me, therefore I'm gonna save you.
I'm not gonna kill him, Wesley. Angelus, don't care what you thought you sprung me for, Angel's the only one in my life who's never given up on me. There's no way I'm giving up on.
That's why it had to be you.
Eliza just, you know, she brings such incredible intensity and integrity to the screen the moment she's there.
Okay, let's get down to it. We're gonna keep this hunting party tight. Gun, right?
Yeah.
Love the name. You're a good fighter.
I hold my own.
That's a shame. You're with me, Wes, and the kid. In case anyone has any other ideas, this is a salvage mission, not search and destroy. Okay?
She goes to try and capture Angelus to save Angel. And in so doing, Angelus kills the beast.
Knew it.
Oh, crap. You mean killing the beast really does bring back the sun? I thought that was Angel's retarded fantasy.
I guess we'll just have to take a rain check on that whole eviscerating you thing. Just you and me now, Faithy.
Catch you later.
We sort of knew there would be an interesting dynamic in the former bad girl, Faye, going against our hero on the show called Angel, who becomes the bad guy as Angelus.
What did you do? Come on, I'll give you one more.
It was a big deal bringing him, and we knew to bring Faith in, to bring him down. It was all there. It was all there pretty much from the beginning.
anything we can do for Faith now? Finish what she started.
You mean reinstall Angel?
Impossible. We've been over this. No jar, no soul. No soul, no Angel.
I don't think so. I think you need a witch.
Allison comes over because she has to re-ensoul Angel, because the other people are kind of messing it up.
Having Willow on the show is really exciting because there's nobody whose energy is more different from what we do on Angel than Allison Hannigan.
You must be Angel's handsome yet androgynous son.
It's Connor.
And the sneer's genetic, who knew?
Although she herself has gone to the apocalyptically evil place, she cannot help but have this bright, you know, intimate energy.
Oh, and it's the Marlboro Man. Or at least his extra stubbly, mentally unstable, insomniac, first cousin of, for the love of Hecate, somebody stop me.
She has a youthfulness that, you know, sort of anchors Buffy as a show. And to have her show up on Angel, you know, all perky, and be as powerful and as, you know, as sort of grown up as these people, yet have that completely different just energy is really exciting.
Find your target, leave my side. Let loose the soul.
Once Angelus is put back in the box of Angel, Faith goes back to Sunnydale to help out there.
And then it was revealed to us, you know, Charisma told us she was pregnant. You know, I was going to have a baby, which certainly threw us for tizzy because we went, you're a big bad. We've got to have a big bad who's going to be 9 months pregnant by the time we get to episode 16, 17. How do we deal with that?
We talked about the King Arthur myth a lot, you know, and just Arthur's son trying to kill him and sort of the Oedipal jealousy and that sort of thing. And so bringing that in, it also explained, okay, this is what Connor really is. This is where he came from. And we started finding ways to sort of connect all the dots that we've been setting up over the last few years.
It's always been the big mystery of why or how did Darla and Angel have a child, because vampires are sterile. And we find out this miracle birth was basically created as kind of like the secret ingredient, all planned out to sleep with Cordelia and create this super being.
We're having a baby.
Cordelia became pregnant, and I assume it's with my child.
He's such a victim of circumstance, and it really plays out that way. In episode 17, Inside Out, you really see that. You really see that he is caught in the middle. He's caught between good and evil. There's a scene where Darla, his mother, returns to try to get him, to sway him to the side of good, which is strange considering, you know, Darla was so evil. But her last speech that Tim Minear wrote for her before she staked herself to allow him to be born, we rephrase that.
I did so many terrible things, Connor. So much destruction, so much pain. You were the one good thing I ever did, the only good thing.
And she tries to get him not to make this horrible human sacrifice to allow Cordelia to give birth, and Cordelia wins and talks him into it. And in that one moment, he really kind of loses his soul.
Connor, listen to me.
It's not her.
You have to let her go.
It's your father. This is how much he hates you.
I love you. Please.
Torturing you with this sad imitation of your dead mother.
Don't let her do this.
Are you gonna let them do this to us? Are you gonna let them kill our baby?
Connor, listen to me.
You are not my mother.
Out of the union of Cordelia and Connor comes this goddess.
I am named Jasmine. I am a higher power that has come from the great beyond to enjoy Earth and all its fecundities and all its fabulousness, and to, you know, of course, wreak havoc, as any decent angel character would do.
We are all just so taken by her, and we all consider her to be just this ultimate goddess, and literally we drop to our knees when we see her and just praise every single thing that she does.
My God.
People keep saying that.
I'm just gonna do this.
The hotel in Los Angeles in general becomes a place of tremendous danger because Jasmine and her telepathic powers, which she's able to use kinetically through all of the human race, she's able to see anyone, feel all that, know all their thoughts and feel all their feelings. So she has this sort of tentacle effect throughout the human race.
Hello. And thank you all for coming. Nida Shao Hai Hui Guoga Chen Gang Bei Ai De Sutsa.
But the problem is that she's made everyone really, really happy, but she's just sort of eating people on the side, so we're kind of at this like, oh, well, everyone's happy, but she's eating a couple of people a day.
Fred figures out how to break the spell of Jasmine through Jasmine and Cordelia's blood, which is presumably some kind of chromosome similarity that if some of it gets into your bloodstream, you see Jasmine for who she is. All of the gang are returned to their senses and realize that the influence of Jasmine is spreading globally, and they are four or five little people who happen to know the truth about her, which is that she is eating innocent people to gain her power. Having tried to break the spell on Connor unsuccessfully, we've had to leave Connor and Cordelia behind, and so Angel and Gunn and Fred and Lauren and Wes are out there trying to come up with some kind of plan for how to save the world from Jasmine.
She has a name and it has power over her. That's why she keeps it a secret.
Angel, that creature, it came from a world that's worshipped Jasmine for millennia. A world that we can reach through this.
We have to send Angel into another dimension in order to have the final conflict with Jasmine. So he goes to a hell dimension where none of us would survive.
Oh, hell.
Do you have any idea what you've done?
What I had to do.
No. No, Angel. There are no absolutes. No right and wrong. Haven't you learned anything working for the Bowers?
The interesting flip on that is the apocalypse was actually world peace. I mean, for whatever bad that Jasmine represented, she was going to provide them with a world where everybody, there were no wars, there was no crime, there's no hatred, there's no anything, anger. But there's no free will.
I offered paradise. You chose this.
Because I could. Because that's what you took away from us. Choice.
And look where free will has gotten you.
Hey, I didn't say we were smart. I said it's our right.
The human will not accept the idea of being enslaved and, you know, and killed at random. And even though, you know, if you do the numbers, Wolfram and Hart has a point about, well, you know, maybe the world would have been better. Maybe, you know, that's the way to achieve mankind's happiness. But we never will because, you know, we're individuals and we can't work that way. We'd break down.
Angel's ruined everything. But he can't defeat both of us. You still believe in me, don't you? You still love me?
Yes.
Got her.
Ultimately, you know, it's what they did is what I think had to happen, yet it's not something that they can ever feel comfortable about having done.
It puts them in a gray area, which hello, enter Lila Morgan again, to the queen of the gray areas, who offers them the keys to Wolfman Hart and says, you know what? You know, you just destroyed world peace. You're our boys.
Congratulations. Game over. Guess what? You win, which is why I'm here. I have been authorized to make you kids an offer.
She's here to basically give us the keys to the office and say, it's all yours. You're in charge now, so you figure it out.
Why?
Think of it as a reward.
Reward for what?
Ending world peace.
That's not what happened.
No?
Jasmine was creating a slave state.
Right, where the slaves are full of giggly joy and love. Ugh, what a nightmare.
We've got them, sort of in the belly of the beast at Wolfram and Hart. It's gonna change their lives enormously. They're gonna have access to everything they need and everything they want and everything they can do to fight evil, but at the same time, they're going to be, you know, in the heart of where the evil is, and the question really is, can they get through that without becoming corrupted themselves?
There's no way this is gonna go well. It was a heavy season as far as exposition was concerned, just with conflict and stories and where each character was really heading. So it was very heavy with that. So as far as keeping it moving was concerned, we really challenged us as actors to keep it moving.
Working with the cast was fantastic. I mean, they really get along. They really give it 110%. They really want to be here and they want to do a great job. And it's a very collaborative effort.
A lot of people really connect with the material and they connect with the, you know, the metaphors that are made through the writing, and they connect with the characters, hopefully.
It's a show that really focuses on story and development of character. And we see these characters kind of really develop over time, and you kind of take that ride with them.